Break. Again, I could have healed him in and put him on the bed or something. There's options. The great thing about coming into a room where we're now going to relax and letting the dog free is that I get to see him make mistakes, correct the mistakes, and then send him to a command, which creates less stress because the dog gets to try the things he wants to try. It doesn't work out, and then he's told what to do, rather than me coming right in. And this is for practice when you first go home the first couple of weeks. Coming right in, telling him to go to place, and then, you know, it's the first few times we do it, he starts whining, I correct him, of course, yeah, and he shuts up. But he's whining because he wants to do the things that are in his head, which could be going into that room, sitting around, or coming over here. So both of those are off the limits. He shouldn't be going into any room. He shouldn't be leaving the room that I'm in. He shouldn't be leaving the room that I let him in unless I told him to. He can't just pick up and go downstairs or go into the bathroom. No. That's a correction and then a recall and then I'll let him free again. They learn, and Riggins knows this, like, this is the room I put you in, this is the room you stay in. You don't have access, you don't own the place. And we need to send that message. It's all about the message we send. This is why he's not fucking with me. You know, this is why he's listening to me, because I'm sending these messages when we're interacting. I'm saying, and I don't abuse it. But, so what I do is I let him free, and I'll do something. I'll cook myself something, I'll do something. He'll mess up, he might whine, he might do something I don't want, I get to correct it, send him away. And I'll say, ow, get out of here. Maybe he'll go down and lay down. Good. Then he'll learn that's what you need to do next time. But there's less stress because he tried the thing that was on his mind, so there, and he got the punishment, so now he's less likely to want to do it, which means he's not thinking about it, which means there's no whining. You understand what I'm saying? If this is over your head, it's okay. Sometimes I'm wondering if I'm making any sense to him. But yes, allowing him to make choices, make a bad one, get corrected, then directed to go lay down in the beginning of the session. Because this is a session. Like I said, coming out of the kennel with him, you're a session. So we just did a walk, that's a session. We're coming in here to hang out, it's a session. I want him to make bad choices. I'm not telling him what not to do first, so that's not on his mind anymore. And then tell him what to do. So I just let him be. And listen, what ends up happening is he's gonna end up just making the right choice. He's gonna lay down, waiting for you, all that good stuff, okay? And that's not to say don't practice the commands, it's not it, but this is something that needs to happen early on during the transition of being home. After we've done some command stuff, we need to get into one of the days, it's time to start bringing him into the living room and not giving him command, letting him make some mistakes, correcting him, and watch him find comfort on going over to that place bed because he knows there he's always okay. But he doesn't know exactly what might upset you, what the rules are. The rules are you can't leave the room. How do you know that? Well, because you tried and got corrected. That's how you know. And now he knows, because that's how you really teach a dog, right? It's like, don't do that. Like, what's really going to teach you not to do that? Because if he goes over there and gets corrected, then he's going to say, okay, don't do that, right? So we were raising him, letting him try all the stupid stuff that they try. But the remote's right on my person, and I'm ready to correct him at any time. That's why he's not doing anything. He's waiting for my direction, because he's like, if I start doing independent stuff, history tells me I made bad choices and get corrected. But if I listen to this guy, everything's good. So that's why he's like, tell me what to do. Tell me what to do. He wants me to tell him what to do right now, and I'm not purposely not telling him what to do, because I want him to forget. A few minutes from now, he'll forget about me, and he'll go do something stupid. And I'll correct him. And that's how I tighten this dog up, and I can trust him more. Another thing is, he's free until he does something stupid. That's another way of teaching. Like, you're free until you went over there and started whining at the doors. I'm not correct for doing something away. And now I'm holding your tongue, we'll be over there and be quiet. That didn't happen until you started interrupting the environment. I'm over here doing something peaceful, and now I start hearing you. Another way I can hear you is if you're paid, if you're doing this. Click, clack, click, clack, click, click, clack. That's gonna get you corrected. Maybe he doesn't know it yet, but it does. Because I don't wanna hear that. Not only do I not want to hear that, but dogs will do this. It's resting time, stop moving. They'll correct dogs who start to try to play while they're trying to relax because it says, no, that's not the way we want this environment. The leader gets to choose the feeling of the environment, the vibe. Are we gonna be playing in here? Ah, I get to choose that. Or are we gonna be relaxing? If I want to relax and he's going against it, I'm gonna simply correct him for high energy while I'm trying to relax and let him notice that you have to read the room. If I'm looking like this over here at the countertop getting coffee, that's a good cue that you need to do what Riggins is doing. And Riggins wasn't told to go to that bed, right? If Riggins fucks up, he gets corrected and then told to go to that bed. So when Regan starts to think that he's gonna fuck up, he's like, oh, this situation's kind of like, I might mess up. He'll put himself on the bed, and these dogs will do the same thing because they know they're safe there. If they don't trust them to their behavior, they're like, you know, guests are coming, you watch them, hear the knock, put themselves on the place bed. This is the kind of stuff we're looking for. And then they get good boys. They get off the place bed, they bark, they do something stupid, they're getting corrected. This is how we raise them. This is how we raise them. Look, his choices, these are on his own. But look what I do. Right? You give him one of these, let him know he did a good boy in that moment. I'm not over the top with it. You know? But, so now I would be doing something. What do? I got a phone call to make or something. I got to paint, you know, something to do. I'm hanging out in here for 10, 15 minutes, getting food, rejuvenating, then I'm heading to the next spot. Maybe I go out to my studio. If I go out to my studio, you know, I'll heal him out the door like I always do. I'll go to the door, I'll recall him to me, or I can heal him from here, over the door, whatever. I'll use my command to get to my studio, and when I get into my studio, I'm down to a place, because that's a different scenario. That's not the living room. In the studio, much like maybe you bring him to work, I want him to know there's one behavior that you do here. There aren't choices. This particular situation, which is me and you in the studio where I'm working at the desk, there's only one thing I want you to do and nothing else, which is lay on that bed. That's it. And so I will tell him to do that and make sure that he understands that's his behavioral choice, right? That's the one. That's the thing that we do here. And now I'm creating the beats throughout my day, how I want him to behave in the given context of our day. Another thing is we're living my life. We're not living his life. So that means he has to fit into my life, not me fit into his life, right? You don't want a title bratty dog or a kid, and that, you know, there's a certain amount of respect you get by demanding it and going after that respect, which means, you know, I get to choose the day. So I have a dog, I'm responsible, I'm gonna get him out and stuff, but we're not gonna go out an excessive amount because I don't like to. If I liked to, we would. But I'm not just going to because I have you now. We'll go out, enough. We'll have a walk in the morning. We might do some mild potty break stuff where you get to stretch your legs in the afternoon. And then we might do something a little bit in the evening. But then, you know, in total, it's like an hour and a half. The rest of the time, you're just hanging out with me. You're just included. You're there at the studio. You're with me when we're hanging out with the family. You're here, and that's where the real meat of your life is all that in-between time when he's hanging out. That's the reward, and we've talked about this. Is the inclusion. I don't need to add anything with it by like, and with him, honestly, if you gave me this dog and you said you can have him, I'd take him, and we're not gonna go, I'm probably never gonna play ball with him. He's never gonna go to a sport. I'm not gonna go get him into a class because I don't like people anyway as it is, so I don't wanna go to a class because I don't wanna talk to people, especially dog people. Don't wanna talk to them. So you know what he's gonna do? He's gonna live with me in the woods and he's gonna love it. And we don't have to play ball, we don't have to play tug, we don't have to do bite work, we don't have to do scent work, we don't have to go through these agility courses, we don't have to do any of that bullshit. We can just live in the woods together, imagine that. And it's awesome. And it's my life. And he'll enjoy it. We'll go riding in our little side by side, you know, we'll have our bonds, but dude, I don't like going to a class or group of people and you know, doing all this stuff. So sorry, but we're not doing that. He won't know the difference. He won't give a fuck. He'll be happy because I'm not going to condition him to be an athlete. You know, some people think they have to tire the dog out all the time, even though he's a Malinois. I'm living with him right now. I'm living with him for 8 weeks. I'm telling you right now. He's well behaved, and I don't give him any more exercise than any of the other dogs. Doesn't get a lick more than Sparkles. Sparkles gets more than him. And he's fine, more than fine. He's great. It's because this is what he knows here. This is it. I never showed him something else and then took it away. That's where you fuck up. Where you're like, look at this grandiose life. We're gonna go and do this, and then we're gonna go and do this every day, and then we're gonna run 3 miles here, and go swimming here, and then whoops, I got a new job and I don't have time for you, or I had a kid and I don't have time. Something happened and it's now taken away, and now the dog's like, if he just never knew, it just never knew, I think he's fine. Now that's not to say these guys don't have higher drive and all that shit. Yeah, he does. Everything he does is more intense by like 10, right? So if he's running up the hill, they're all running up the hill. They're all on like 2 or 3. You're on like 3. You know, they're going up the hill. He's on 11. He's like, I'm going up the fucking hill and going back down the hill. And I'm going back up the hill all before they went up once. That's how he's getting his exercise out. He's doing it more times, you know? And he's having fun, and he's learning, this is what we do, we move out of the pack, we check a place out, we mark, you know, we're doing normal stuff, we're not doing obsessive stuff, we're focusing on you know, whatever it may be. Because the reason we're not doing that is because I don't like doing that. That's why. So if you like doing that, then you do it. But my point is that the dog, he's at the best he's ever been, right? And we're not catering to his needs like that. He's not doing 3 miles because I don't want to do 3 miles, right? We're gonna go do a mile. And that's it. And that's plenty. The rest of the time he's spending time with me, he'll get his exercise through. You know, we go on a potty break, fucking runs around, you know, whatever. Do you like to play ball? Play ball. Like, play ball. I just don't like to. So, that's why I don't. And I'm not going to play ball with him because he likes it and I don't. See, that's the thing. That's where you lose respect for these fucking things. I swear to God. They start thinking that they can come to you and be like, throw that thing. And you're like, okay, I'll throw it, you know. And if you don't have everything else tight, like, if you have a tight relationship, you can do whatever you want. You can play ball, you can do whatever. The dog's not going to fuck with you. I know guys and gales that have dogs completely under control. They live the proper way with them. They can break all the rules. The dog can sleep with them. It's not going to change its behavior. They can get on the couch. It's not going to change its behavior. If you don't have that full circle approach and you actually don't have control over the dog, and they're still saying like, let me out, and you get off your ass and you let them out because they barked at the door, and they take a ball and they put it at your feet and you pick it up and you throw it, and they say I'm hungry because you're whining over here, and then you bend over and you give them something to eat. In all those situations for me, if my dog whines while I'm over here cooking something, he gets corrected and sent away. If he's barking at the door, he's gotta go to the bathroom, he gets corrected and sent away. If he's coming to me, talking on me to go play with him, he gets corrected and sent away. Because I'm a dog. I'm leading them. A dog if I was a dog who was older, the elder, who was kind of leading these guys, all that would be corrected. I'm whining at your food, corrected. I'm barking and disturbing your environment, corrected. I'm coming over here trying to elicit play while you don't want it. Correct it. The dog would correct it. So that's why I correct it, and that's why other trainers correct it, because that's how dogs think. That's where they live. If you don't like it, why don't you correct me? I would expect you to correct me if you didn't like it, right? So this leads the dog to feel like you are not a very strong animal, and that leads a dog to growl at you while you're on the couch, while it's on the couch. That leads a dog to growl at you while over something. Because now they say I can challenge them because, look, I'm ordering them around all day. They listen. Like, I can be a dog and do what dogs do and see you as below me. So now I'm going to then be the one to growl and take charge. It's just how it goes. So the message we send to him, right? So, and here's where it all goes wrong, though. And it's not him. It's not this dog. This is all the dogs that come here. We get them. They're fucking cute. They're so cute. All we want to do is play with them and have fun. So that's all we do. And then we say, whoops. That's what happens. Instead of saying, when I get this thing, I'm going to raise it in a way where we have the right relationship to the world. Me, you, the world. That includes all of our folk. That's the kind of relationship that I want with my dog. If I'm raising it from a puppy and it has to live with me and my family, the dynamic I need is it's me and you, dog. And the thing that we have going on that, you know what I'm talking about, right? Riggins knows what I'm talking about. That, it's me and you, and then it's the rest of the world, okay? It's not you and the world, it's me and you and the world. And you know that you have to go through me to get to the world, because if you try to get to the world without going through me, you're gonna have a problem. That's mine and his dynamic, that's mine and his dynamic. That's mine and the dynamic of the dogs, especially the difficult dogs that come through here, and that needs to be yours. And that's the dynamic of a parent, of a father, of a mother. Right? We're not then just gonna be like, you know what? That is a good idea. Because we're adult humans that come from a different place where I'm gonna say, what the hell is going on here? Knock it off. Right? Calm down. Because it's our life for them. They have to look and read us and say, now is the time? You know, they have to, you know. So, and I'm not saying you can't play with your dog and be goofy and all that. You know what I'm saying? Give yourself. You're not gonna get a follower for free like that. I have a follower now, but not, it wasn't free, right? I have a follower out of all these dogs, but it wasn't free. So I learned the skill of when I feel confrontation to go into the submissive state where I can then calm and I take direction, it all goes away. They learned that they have control over it to a degree. And so that means that they can turn it off. They know they can turn it off, the pressure from me, that is. And so they do, and then they see me just change, and I say, good, and I'm soft to them. And they say, oh, so if I go into that space, he goes into that space. If I leave it, he'll leave it. Right? If I submit, he'll relax. If I start to do this towards him, he's going to come back at me. So they learn that they're in control, and they learn it as a coping skill. Under stressful situations, just submit. And the more they do it, the more they see that nothing is dangerous. You're living in a very safe life. You're living with humans that know what they're doing. It's safe at my house. It's safe out there on the city streets with me. The cars are safe. They start to realize all that because now they're calm and they're watching the world rather than being stimulated. They're not learning shit in that state of mind. That's why we're in this classroom. We can't have, it's like being in a classroom and the kids are standing on the desk screaming. They're not learning anything, right? There's a reason why those kids used to get a paddle. I know. How terrible, right? I'm not saying, yes. Get a paddle for standing on the desk. It worked though, didn't it? And all you had to do is give it to one of them in front of the other ones. And then they stopped. It did happen not too long ago. It works. It clears the cobwebs, and then the kids and the dogs pay attention. Right? And then you can say, good job for paying attention, and show them the rewards for paying attention. And naturally, the dog's going to choose the easier path, which is to just stay like this. This is what he's choosing. This is his choice right now. Right? And every now and then, I'll remind him he's doing a good boy, you know? He gets his free time, and we let him run around, and we have our free time, but right now, this is not the time we're delivering. So again, in order to get a follower, the dog is not going to give it to you for free. You ever watch a dog whisperer? The dogs fight with everything they have until they're exhausted, and then he's still there, and they submit. And then all of a sudden, the next day with this dog, the next day with Fanny, and the next few days, the dog's trying. They're doing something they didn't do before. They're trying. They're looking at me, and they're saying, okay, what are we doing? And I'm saying, great, I'm glad you're paying attention, because the things I'm about to teach you are not that difficult. But they would have been if I tried to teach you in the state that you were in before we did the ritual of me claiming leadership, right? So that's why we do that before we train the commands. The only command we're training first is going to be the recall, so that we can make sure if the dog tries to choose flight, we allow them to choose flight, and then they get corrected for choosing flight when they're a distance away, and recall back to the conversation until they don't choose flight anymore and they submit. It's a way of further domesticating the dog and getting them to be under the control of a human. And it works, but there is this process, this ritual, where a dog will choose to just leave, which is flight, or to tell you to fuck off, which is flight. Okay? That is natural. That is normal. That's part of the process, always has been, for the submitting stuff. Watch any dog whisperer, and you're going to see the dog's going to have a little batshit crazy moment before they get the submission. Normal. If we stop doing the batshit crazy moment, we say, well, that technique didn't work. It's like, well, it was working. You just chickened out or didn't have enough knowledge or blame it on the tool. Like, well, that made the dog aggressive. No, the dog's going to give you a fight. It's supposed to. And then it submits. And now you know what I can do to him? I can correct him as firm as I need to with no worries about him retaliating at me. I don't see it in his eyes. I don't see it in his face. It's not there anymore. Because he knows that if he strikes at me, he has a memory of what will happen. So therefore, it's off the table for him, because I did it right. You know what I mean? He's not going to strike at me. I would have to be really, I don't know what I have to do to get this guy to strike at me at this point. You know what I mean? He trusts me, and that's another thing. He trusts me. I don't overuse the control, you know, that you can have on a dog. And he respects me. But we had those tough conversations. And so here's the thing. The e-collar has a lot of that association to it, because we did a lot of that. All the punishment that you're going to give the dog is the same thing that I gave him with that e-collar, the same sensation. But the relationship, hopefully this long talk will give you an idea of how the dog needs to look at you. He can't be bumping. He can't just be running, run up to me and start bumping into me. Like, now that makes more sense, right? It's like, yeah, well, that does kind of make sense, because that's him coming up to me and telling me he's bored in a rude way, and then I praise it because it's cute. Which it is for a little while. But again, imagine if you were responsible for a 2-year-old at your feet. It's gonna change, it fucking changes things when you're in your living room and you have a vulnerable little, beautiful little kid and you have this monster running around. It changes, everything in your demeanor is gonna change. You're either gonna say, fuck it, and I don't care about the situation and let what happens happen, or you're gonna say, not in my house, dude, you need to relax. Because now there's a real reason for you to relax, because there's a soft little thing in the middle of the room. And I finally actually have to flex control on you. And because we never practiced, I don't have it. And now we're in over our head, right? And now I'm frustrated and all this stuff is there. Wow. What if you had that little toddler with you at all times? When you're home, pretend that you need that level of control and you will get it. You will get it. Even if you never have a kid, you need to have that kind of control because we need to have control over him when we step outside our door or when somebody comes into our door. Okay? Remember, the out command, right? That's just to give you an example. He's not doing anything wrong. He's doing great. But if I wanted to out him, I would give a trigger right now. I'll create one by opening that door, and he'll say, I want to go out the door, and then I'll say out, right? And what that is a pointing finger in the other direction. So, right? Out. And so that lands in his head that that's not for him. Now, look at me and look at him. If he takes a step towards that door, I'm going to punch him and send him away, right? Because now he's headed towards the thing I clearly just said not to, right? If I'm over here for a minute and he starts creeping his way over here, what I would like to see is you step over, correct him to this, and send him out. He's right there, that's fine. He can either walk further away or lay down, fine. Come closer to the thing that I just claimed, and this is what happens. Once they know that, this is the behavior that you do, right? And from here, I can tell him to lay down, I can tell him to go over to a place. I'm right here, he's right there, I can talk to him, he can see me, but I'm next to the trigger. And okay, so this is a trigger, I created it, it's something that he wants. Replace it with anything. Start with the door, but then it can be a person, it can be anything. It's the fact that he wants it and you said leave it alone. How does he respond? Does he do that? Then we're in good shape. If he does that, we're in good shape. Look, no stress, just wait. Just wait. The mind is very clear. He really enjoys being told that I did the right thing because I left him hanging for a second, like he didn't know if he was doing the right thing. Because I'm not up his ass, I'm not kissing his ass. See that movement right there? You see my leg? You see they know. He knows. So he started to go over there, I lifted my leg to block, and then he looked at me like a good boy says, oh, I'm sorry, and then I flung my finger and he went over there, lay down, took a deep breath. All because of everything I explained to you, the conversation, the ritual. Now I can claim anything I want. And if he really wants it, and he wants to fight it, I'll correct him on this, happy and it'll produce that. Okay? So, but look, sending the dog away is important. So if I was a couple that owned this dog, I would practice sitting on that couch. I would practice having him in free time, giving him some loving. You're a good boy, feeling good. He's like, yeah, I'm fucking back home, you know? And then you guys just sit on the couch without offering him, and he comes up to you and tries to be part of that, and you say, out. And then if he doesn't leave immediately, correct him and say, out. We want to be alone on this couch right now, and we don't want him near us. Oh, that's sad. What if there was a baby there? What if there was a little soft little baby? And now you said, now it justifies it, right? You have to teach him the skill before the baby's there. Or before something, a situation comes up that you really need control. So this is practicing control, right? So you sit on the couch and he comes over blah, 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 and you say, out. And if he listens immediately, then fuck you, I'm out. Then he's sorry. He lays down over here and he's quiet. You're good. He's not going to do that the first time. You have to earn it. So you know what to do. You say, out. He doesn't do it. Boom. Stand up. Preferably the person who said out, drag him away with your finger. He comes over here, fine, go sit back down. He starts whining, correct him from a distance, right? Can't stop whining, out again. Out even further. I don't care if he leaves the room, just out. And then some time goes by where he's quiet and everything's good. I'll go get you and let you back in. We'll let some time go by. We'll get you feeling good again. And then we're gonna go sit on the couch. And you're gonna start following this. You might even stop yourself. And then we're going to say, good, go on, go lay down. That's a great situation to start with, where you're claiming not only the couch, you're controlling whether or not he's part, when he's included and when he's not. If you include a dog all the time with everything, they're always included in everything. And then one day, they're not included hardly at all anymore, for obvious for reasons. Life changes, right? Like, you got a different job, you have a kid, things happen, right? Now we have a problem because the dog doesn't have the skills to be told to go. So I'm telling you to practice sending him away from social situations, even though you don't have to practice. There's no reason. He could be on that couch with you, we could be enjoying ourselves, but we need to practice stuff we didn't practice when he was younger. Now, if we do this for the next year, we're good, we don't have to do it anymore, okay? But you're gonna push him to be like, you know, remind him and show him and set these situations up. And so you're gonna realize you have a lot of control over this guy. He's very much like a puppy with us right now. How should I say this? He's mature, but his energy is so soft. There's no, I don't feel like he's gonna come at me. I don't feel like he's gonna try to give me an attitude. I don't feel like he's gonna bitch at me. He's just gonna listen. And that's because I put him through weeks of every day we wake up, and it's like, we're gonna go through some stuff today. And if you do good, you do good. But if you don't, you don't, and I'm gonna let you know. And then when I'm done with it, this is the important part. When I'm done with it, go in and you count. Even when we're home. But again, that sounds terrible. Well, that sounds mean. What if there is a 2-year-old right here though? It's like now you're winning. Now it makes sense. Yeah, just put him in his fucking count. See what you gotta do. You gotta live in a situation. What if it was post-apocalyptic and we need him to be quiet because there's zombies out there? You'd fucking wring his neck for making a noise because he's gonna eat your baby. They're gonna eat your baby. Like, you need that level of control. Be quiet.
Well, why does he have to be quiet?
He doesn't have to because it's 2021 and everything's safe. I get it. He doesn't have to. But what if it wasn't safe? What if right outside this door there's something that's gonna kill us and he's in here making a fucking noise, barking and shit, and we can't shut him up? We just can't figure out how to shut him up. You would find out so fast how to shut him up. And you'd get it done. You'd get it done. But we're not in those situations, so we don't have a reason to actually have to. There's no pressure to really shut up. If there was, it would have been then, right? Or if it's like, he's on the couch and he's growling at us, it's like, well, you need to get him off that couch because this lady's in labor and we're about to lay her down there. It's like, you know, there's some real pressure. We actually need to get him off the couch. When we need to pretend those situations are those situations, because at the end of the day, that's why we do this stuff. That's why when we tell the dog to get off the couch and browse at us, we can't just leave it alone, because that means someday we're going to need him to do something when we really need him to, and he's not going to listen. He's going to have that tool that worked before to use on us. And it's not only going to be over the couch. It's going to go over any situation where I don't like you telling me what you're telling me right now. And we've seen dogs like this turn into dogs without help. You guys got him in early, which is great. Without help, a dog like this, one day, he'll be 3 or 4 years old. Y'all be sitting in your living room. Somebody's gonna get up and head into the kitchen and get mauled. Yeah, I know. Doesn't seem like he would do that, does it? Yep. That's the kind of shit we're talking about. So we can't let them feel like they're high up in the hierarchy. Just can't. Okay. I think that's about it, really. Other than when you're going out in outings, start with stuff. Start, like, here's the thing. If you haven't proofed him around dogs behind fences and like walking by dogs, don't go to a restaurant. Because you're like, I'm not going to work on that because that's not fun, but going to a restaurant is fun. But then at the restaurant, a dog shows up. And then we weren't ready for it and it became a shit show because we're in a patio instead of walking by where we could actually deal with it first. And it became a shit show, and that was the experience that we now gave him, and then we leave, and that's what we left with. You know, remember, everything we give him is an experience that stacks on top of another experience to lead to a belief system. So, when you put him in his kennel, he's in that kennel, he's not having any unwanted experiences. You let him out, you choose what experiences to give him, you put him back in there, and you repeat that day after day until his brain of his is different. It thinks differently. He sees dogs and it says, this is what dogs mean now. Right? Because we went and changed it. We went and brought you around the dog and you kind of got, you know, amped up, we corrected you. You calm down, we say good boy, we leave, we try again the next day. Until you see and calm yourself down, good boy, now we're starting to change you, you see? That's it, that's what you gotta do. You got the tools to do it now. You know, and we're gonna be going to your house, we're gonna go into their house and doing a session in their neighborhood, so we're gonna do a lot of the work, but then you gotta keep it up, you know? If we find a nice fence with a dog barking behind, we're not gonna avoid that fence, we're gonna find that fence as much as possible to say, what are you gonna do, wreck? That's how you do it. That's how you do it. Break. You're a good boy. Yeah. And then once we're past all that bullshit, we can just enjoy it. Like, because I know at any minute, if I shush or if I say knock it off, he has all those memories tied back. He's just going to listen to me. You know, I have that leverage. I have that relationship with him, if that's what you want to call it. So now I can start breaking rules with him, and I can start having more fun with him. But first, we went through all that stuff. We made sure that was clear before we went in. Start doing all the fun stuff, okay? And that goes for every dog that's in this program, you know, that especially difficult to have. But guys like this, you don't want to take the risk of letting them slip. It's an expensive program. You don't want to send them back, you know? And he's in such a good space with me. Look how he's treating me. I hope you can see his body language and how soft he's being, why he's in my bubble. That's because if he's not, he's going to get a nice knee and told him to go. Because I'm a dog. I have to be. And dogs, this is how they do. If I was Riggins and he was up here like trying to nibble on me and stuff, get away from me. Doesn't mean I don't like you. It means I don't like when you do that. And that's another thing is like, our dog won't like it. People got to get off that. I think I've heard that. I haven't heard it in a few years. I used to hear it all the time where people are afraid their dog won't like them. then I heard it again, like recently, like twice in the past couple of days, and I'm like, that's gonna really put a hinder to shit right there. Imagine's like, well, I don't want him eating the baby, but if I slap him for doing it, he's not gonna like me. It's like that person should not be leading the dog. Take that person, pluck them right out of there, and get a different one to lead this dog, because they can go and make his meal for him and make his bed and you know that kind of stuff. But they shouldn't be doing the leading. That's not the right mentality. The mentality is like, you know, if you're doing something I don't like, I'm gonna go over there and tell you I don't like it. Until you don't make me do that anymore. You actually, when you're with me, you look at me and say, hey, what would you like me to do? And then I reward that. That's our relationship. You know, I don't care if you like me. I just care if you listen. And that happens to produce respect. And you trust me because I'm doing everything with you, like feeding you and all this stuff. And all of a sudden, you not only do you love me, you suck up to me. Because you want to be on my good side. Dogs don't like people they don't respect. You know, they will love on you and stuff because it's mutually good. But they're not trying to please you, right? This dog was trying to please me. So he'll go out of his way to do things that he thinks I like. So if somebody comes to the door right now and they knock, he's gonna have an urge to do something that he wants to do, but then he's gonna stop because he's with me and he's gonna say, what would he like me to do based off from the past in this situation? He's gonna say, last time that somebody came to the door, he liked it when I was quiet and went over there. So they do that. And then when you see your dog doing that, good boy, right? Dog's trying to please you. Dog who likes you. Dog who's, you're not afraid of me. You wonder why? Because every time I correct him, first of all, the first time we got into a fight is because he started. He struck, right? I didn't strike at him first. He strikes at me first. That's how it always goes. If a dog decides that they want to strike at you, boom, and then you have a little back and forth. When it's over and you win, they're not afraid of you, especially if you end it properly, because they're like, well, I struck at him. Right? Like, I didn't just come in the room and start beating on the dog. The dog made a decision to fight me. And there's techniques to get a dog to say, okay, I'm going to fight you. And when they do, you know, whatever. It's not hard to get a biting dog to feel like doing that. They're willing to bite. They're willing to bite, but they have a very low threshold, right? I could just stare at him and he'd probably growl at me when I first met him. You know what I mean? It's that easy. But then he strikes first, right? He has no interest in striking anymore, because it leads to what that leads to. So therefore, biting is not on the table. So he treats me differently. If biting was on the table, that's different. Then he would growl and stuff because he still thinks he can use it. He knows because he's tried. Did not work out well. And he knows it's because he challenged me, right? So they all go out of their way to not bite. So biting's not on his mind. If biting was on his mind, he would think about pushing me around a little bit. It's because like, well, I could always just bite you. You know, so they're not fully committed to you. It's like, if I see a dog thinking about biting me, I'm like, this isn't what I do literally, but figure, kind of like I say, oh yeah? Like I say, if I see a bite in there, I'm going to, this is not what you should do. I'm going to then want to talk about that bite. So what's making you want to bite? Is it because I'm close to you? What if I did this? Oh, now you really want to bite me. What if I walked over here and I just touched you on the butt? Oh, there's the bite. And now we can talk about the bite. So now, after a day or two of this, we walk in and the dog thinks, okay, I'm not gonna bite because I know where that goes. So what's left? Biting is fighting. So what's left? If we have a recall, you can't run away. So what's left? It's just to do what I say, to interact with me in a more soft way. And that's what you see dogs do. They come up with you. Even biting dogs, big, scary, nasty Rotties, Pitties, Shepherds, nasty looking. You go through this process, they're like a puppy in your arms. They just want to come up and they just want to cuddle with you because they want to know that you guys are good. So after that battle, if you will, every dog, we have a join up where the dog, you know, everything calms down. The dog's kind of in a different space. I will sit down like this and the dog will come close to me and sniff me and usually brush up on me, sometimes end up even right here, depending on the personality of the dog. Sometimes they're prideful and they don't want to give it up all the way, but they'll sit next to me and they'll touch me though. They'll be touching me and they'll just be sitting next to me and they'll let me pet them like this. And this is a bite, this is like a dangerous dog that I don't know, right? But we just post fight that they, you know, I mean, yeah, I might have touched him on the butt, but he bit me. He went and struck at me, you know? that's what caused the fight in their eyes. So now they say, if I do the opposite of striking, which is like showing this guy that I don't want to fight, which you see submissive behavior, I let them know I like that, and that's our dynamic. Now we're moving forward. We're moving forward from that conversation on. I'm not avoiding it the whole relationship, trying to dodge the bite that's inside my dog. I'm gonna say, let's talk about that so you can understand that's not a valuable option with me, so that you stop looking at me like it is. You know what I'm saying? That's where the change is with the dogs. That's the real change with him. The real change, like I taught him stuff, like commands and stuff and state of mind training and all that stuff. But the real thing is he doesn't think that biting is an option because he knows where it leads, so therefore he's just gonna treat me differently with every scenario. Because if he bites at me, this can happen. He has that memory. That is the most natural way that a pack holds a hierarchy. That is natural. The lack of that is unnatural. The most we want to pretend that punishing a dog or like dogs controlling each other by striking and saying don't do that, that is the most natural shit. We don't do that with a dog, so we cannot have control over them. Unless the times we have control over them is we say, hey Fido, I got something you really want over here. I know you're really hungry and I got some pepperoni. Then the fighter's gonna come up and say, how do I get that pepperoni? How do I get it? And you're gonna say, sit. And he sits and he gets it, you know, and you're like, you can get control on that. But what happens as you're doing this, you got a little time window, right? It's gonna be like 30 seconds to a minute, right? Fighter's getting full. Oh, and plus we've had that pepperoni like every week, you know? You gotta upgrade that shit or something. All of a sudden, if Fido doesn't want your food as much as he wants something else in the environment, which like a squirrel or something, which is all the fucking time, because you always have the food for him, it doesn't work now. It only works if Fido is absolutely starving. He's 50% of his body weight. He's barely alive. Now he'll do anything for this food. It might work. But it doesn't work because eventually the dog's full and they're comfortable and they're living in a comfy house. They see a squirrel, they're like, yeah, I do want that treat, but I want to chase the squirrel first. So I'll go chase the squirrel and then I'll come back to him and get my treat. Or I'll bark at the dog and then I'll come back and get my treat. It does not work. It doesn't. I mean, you can look around yourself. If you're on a 6-month program with a bite dog or a reactive dog and you're still not seeing progress because you're trying to like feed him when he's not barking, let me tell you something. Barking at other dogs is self-rewarding. Self-rewarding, which means me barking at another dog, I'm being rewarded because it's fun. So you don't have to reward it for it to get worse because it's fun by itself. Same with jumping. Jumping's getting worse. Well, we ignore it. It doesn't matter if you ignore it. It's fun even if you ignore it. So therefore, it's pleasurable, so I do it. Barking at other dogs is fun, so I'll do it. Now, how much sense does it make to say this thing that a dog likes to do? Let's reward it for not doing it, but allow it to do it and see that the dog will choose not to do it because it gets rewarded when it doesn't. This is what happens. The dog sees the dog, they bark, that was fun. They stop barking, get some food, that was fun. Bark again, that was fun. Stop barking, get some food. You're not gonna stop it because the barking is as fun or if not more fun than the food. And dogs who aren't doing it because it's fun or are doing it because they're nervous, they're too nervous to eat your fucking food. They're like, food, what are you talking about eating? We're in survival mode right now. Food, I don't eat when I'm in like thinking about going from fight or flight or about to go into a fight with some, you know, dogs walking down the street that I think they're gonna be dangerous. Food is not the thing that I want because I'm nervous. So you get those dogs that are nervous, they don't even eat the goddamn food. It's not the right card to pull. Now, if I was like, the right move to make. Now, if I was like, I wanna teach my Malinois to do a backflip, I'm gonna go get food so I can lure that shit in. That's the right time to use that. But if I want to teach him to not react to other dogs or something, yeah, I'm not going to use food and I'm going to have it done like this. Tomorrow it's done. You know what I mean? Like, he reacts today and tomorrow he's not. Because we're punishing when he does. And we are rewarding when he doesn't, but I'm just petting him. I'm just saying, good, that's a reward. Like, I don't need to be like, oh, bring in the turkey and all this, you know, let's get a play. Right.